I know we left the comfortable territory of binary trees for just a moment to explore 2, 3, 4 trees, and now we can take a breath and return to that familiar space of binary trees, sort of. Except we're going to create them in a way that gives us some of the properties that we got from 2, 3, 4 trees, the good ones, and ignores or avoids some of the bad ones. And the way we'll do that is with a red-black tree. Each node in a red-black tree is marked as either red or black. The root and all leaf nodes, which, by the way, are the null pointers, the empty spaces at the end of what we would have previously considered leaf nodes, and in some of those empty spaces in a binary tree, all of those are treated as black. So when we hit the nulls, those will be counted as black nodes for us. If a node is red, then both its children must be marked black. Every path from a leaf or from a node to its leaves must contain the same number of black nodes. And this gives us some of that property of what we wanted with the 2, 3, 4 trees, where there was a similar height all throughout the tree. It won't be quite as strict, but it will give us some limitations on the height and not having things growing too imbalanced in one place or another. We will need to use an extra bit or boolean to indicate whether a node is marked black or red. So that will give us this indicator of what the status of a node is, except for those nulls hanging off at the ends. Those won't have the indicator. We will notice they're null, and we'll treat them as black nodes. This gives us a measurement of the black height of the tree, meaning the number of black nodes from the root to any of its leaves. And again, that gives us a close approximation of the equal depth piece that we were looking for in B trees and 2, 3, 4 trees. In fact, a red-black tree can be mapped to a 2, 3, 4 tree structurally, but it will not have the empty spaces. So a 2 node is just a single black node that has pointers from it, a single value there. A 3 node is a black and red pair in either direction, a black node parent of a red node child, or, I'm sorry, a black node parent with a right red node child, or a black node parent with a left red node child. And then our 4 nodes will be the complete parent with 2 children. And those will be equivalent to the 2, 3, 4 tree nodes that were full. So these are sort of groupings for those, but you'll notice there are not empty spaces left all throughout the tree the way that they would have been in a 2, 3, 4 tree. Here's another way of drawing a 2, 3, 4 tree, and this maps again some of the pieces inside of our red-black tree. So you'll notice that just having both children does not necessarily make something map perfectly to a 4 node in our 2, 3, 4 tree. This 32, 33, 34 grouping does map, but 30, for example, has both left and right children, but one of its children is a red node and the other child is a black node, so it corresponds to a 3 node. We only count it with its red node child, and that makes it a 3 node in our translation to the 2, 3, 4 tree here. It's worth noting that that property, the important one that we really cared about with the red-black tree, is true here, that we will proceed through the same number of black nodes to get to any leaf from the root. And that's true internally within the tree as well. So from the root to get to any leaf takes stepping through the root as one black node and then 2 more black nodes. and to step from any leaf from 35 requires stepping through only one black node. So the 33 is the black node we would step through here, and the 36 is the black node that we would step to here, but it still counts. It's the one black node step. And so to get to any leaf from the root takes a step through the same number of black nodes. It doesn't put all of our leaves at the exact same height, but it does put them within a limited height from each other, and therefore gives us a decently balanced tree. The leaves, meaning those nulls off the edge, are not shown here. So it is more loosely balanced, a red-black tree is, than an AVL tree. It's not going to be as nicely balanced, and even AVL trees were not strictly perfectly balanced either. But the path from the root to the farthest leaf will be less than or equal to 2 times the path from the root to the nearest leaf. So that means the shortest possible path will be along all black nodes, and the longest path alternates equally between black and red nodes. But that alternation, again, will at most double our length there to get to a leaf node from the root. So there's a bound on how imbalanced it will be. Just like in the AVL trees, we had a bound. They had a stricter bound, though. But the height is still O of log n, because 2 times log n is still O of log n. So to get to anything in the tree, to find within the tree, will take 2 times log n at most, or log n in those best cases. And it's O of log n in either sense. Insertion into a red-black tree begins just the way that you would with any other BST. You look for the location where a value should have been, and you're going to place it there. The new node will replace one of those black leaves, the null spaces, in our tree, and it's colored red. If the parent was black, then our insertion is done, because remember, the rule is around a red node must have 2 black children. So our insertion would be complete if the parent there was black. Otherwise, we've violated the red-black rules, and we have to propagate that up the tree using one or both operations of rotations like we did in AVL trees, and recoloring of nodes to different colors to allow us to have sort of more of that filled in space, similar to how we brought up the middle value in a 2-3-4 tree. We will bring up some of the coloring to distribute the values and still be not in violation of our red-black properties. So when we have a violation of the red-black rule, meaning that the red nodes do not have 2 black children, or that the path from the root to leaves now passes through more black nodes for some values than for others, then we have to propagate that violation. If the current node is the root, then we set the color to black if it's not already. And this can't violate any constraints because it applies to all paths from the root. It increases the tree's black height, meaning the number of black nodes that need to be passed through to get to leaves, by 1. And if the parent node is black, then we have nothing to do because the tree is in a consistent state. We haven't violated that rule about red nodes having black children, and we haven't violated the rules around passing through black nodes to get to leaf nodes. However, the 2 other cases are when the parent's siblings, when the parent and its sibling are both red, or when the parent's sibling is black, but the parent is red. So if we look at B, its parent is A, and then its parent's sibling is D over here. So if both of those are red, then this will violate our rules. And if the parent is red, but the parent's sibling is black, then this will violate our rules as well. This is similar to when we were inserting in a 2-3-4 tree that the A, C, and D are a 4 node. They're a black node with the two red children on it, and therefore they need to be broken up as we come down to ensure space for things. So let's dig a little deeper into those scenarios we were looking at there. If the parent's sibling is red, then you flip the colors of the parent and its sibling to black, and then you flip the color of their parent, the grandparent of your node that you're trying to insert, to red. And so again, this serves as breaking up that black, red, red 4 node that you're seeing there, or full red-black arrangement there, into one that's no longer full and sort of propagates things upward like we would have done in the 2-3-4 tree. It effectively lengthens the tree. Again, just like our operations in the 2-3-4 tree lengthened the tree by moving things upward, this does the same thing. It pushes the black amount of nodes downward and pushes redness upward. It's worth noting that these triangles that are shown here would be some subtrees under those. Each of them would have to have a black root and the same number of black nodes along paths within them. Each of them would have to follow this same rule around red black trees, that from a particular location, getting to leaves should require stepping along the same number of black nodes. You can think of the black nodes as being either the single value in a 2 node or the center value in a 4 node. And so that can help you to see these structures in here. The grandparent node will be the next place that might have had a violation, but everything underneath should be good now if we've done this procedure up above of flipping the parent and the parent's sibling to being black and flipping the grandparent or the parent's parent to being red. Then everything down below should now be fine. Everything below C now has presumably an equal number again. One more black node along each path to get to leaves, but an equal number nonetheless. If the parent's sibling was black and the parent was red, then we have to perform a rotation. This gets us into the structure of the 4 node that we would have seen, where it was the black center and the two red children, by rotating around and modifying some of the colors. So we perform a rotation like an AVL tree, as if the grandparent was out of balance, because it sort of is. If the node is in violation is on an inner subtree relative to the parent, just like in an AVL tree, we're going to do that double rotation. And if it's on an outer subtree relative to the parent, we can get away with a single rotation, again, just like in an AVL tree. We will recolor the former grandparent, which is now a sibling, to be red. And that, again, gives us this structure where, because the uncle, the parent's sibling, was black, it should become the center. The grandparent will now become one of the children of that node, that uncle node, that parent's sibling node, and it should be red because we want the black node in the center and the two red children belonging to it. This turns it into a 4 node from being a 3 node. And then we recolor the former grandparent's new parent to be black. So again, this is so that the center is black. The two children will be red. And so you can watch some visualizations of this kind of operation happening at the link provided there. So to look a little bit at some code that would fix a red-black tree, if we are from a node current, if current has a red uncle, meaning that its parent's sibling is red, then current's parent's color becomes black, as well as the uncle, the parent's sibling's color becomes black, and the parent's parent, or the grandparent, becomes red. Otherwise, current has an uncle or a parent's sibling that is a black marked node. Therefore, we have to do the rotations to this where the grandparent becomes a variable set up here that gets the current's parent's parent. If current is an inner child, we do the double rotations, and if current, then rotate at the grandparent and recolor. So if current was an inner child, we'll have to do one rotation inside here and then another rotation outside. If current was an outer child, we'll skip this first rotation and only do this last rotation here. And then we will recolor in the way that was described there so that we've got the black center, two red children. And then current gets the grandparent, and we will continue to loop through here to propagate these upwards. And if current is root, then we set it to black there. So if we had this color violation, we will have to loop to propagate that color violation upward. If there are some problems in there, for instance, having the red uncle or having the black uncle and the parent color is red, then we have to do some of these different switches to colors or rotations. And we'll keep looping till we reach the root, at which point we can set the root to black. We've propagated the color violation all the way upward, and we know that we had to increase the black length or black height of the tree at the root there. So to summarize, they are less rigidly balanced red-black trees than AVL trees. They can have faster insertion and removal than AVL trees because we have to do fewer of the rotations and things, but we might have slightly slower retrieval because of the fact that we've got that factor of two that we might have to go twice as long to get to a leaf than the perfectly balanced tree would, whereas AVL trees kept a little stricter of a balance to them and cost a little more to maintain. The red-black trees are isomorphic to 2-3-4 trees. I would argue they're a little more complicated to conceptualize than 2-3-4 trees, but they take less storage because we don't have the empty spaces. We have a black node that might have no red children, might have one red child, and those would be less than full if they were in a 2-3-4 tree, but they're not here. They would just have whatever children they have otherwise. They might have a black child on another side or no child there, and those are not as big of a loss in terms of the storage overhead. These are used in the C++ STL map and set implementations because of the fact that they're pretty fast at lookup and they are fast at insertion and removal. They balance these features fairly well.